Let's say that we want to evaluate this indefinite integral right over here. And you immediately say, hey, you got the square root of 4 minus x squared in the denominator. You could try use substitution, but it really doesn't simplify this in any reasonable way. How do you tackle this? And an insight that you might have is, well, this thing, the square root of 4 minus x squared, this looks like something that I might get if I'm dealing with the Pythagorean theorem, if I'm solving for non-hypotenuse sides of the Pythagorean theorem, especially if the length of the hypotenuse is 2, this would be 2 squared, and then the other side is x, then 2 squared minus x squared, this would be the length of the other side. Well, let's just run with that then. So if we have A, and if any of you didn't feel that insight immediately, it's okay. Because to be honest, I actually did not feel that insight probably the first time that I saw things like this. So let's say you have a right triangle. So let's just visualize that insight that we talked about. So if the hypotenuse of the right triangle is of length 2, and let's say this side right over here, actually let me do this side. Let's say this side, actually I'm gonna go with this side. This side right over here is of length x. This side over here is of length x. It's a little counterintuitive because normally we associate this side over here with y, but let's just go with it. This side right over here is of length x. Then what would this side right over here be? What would this other non-hypotenuse length be? Well, just if you solve for it using the Pythagorean theorem, you get that it is going to be the square root of the hypotenuse squared, 2 squared, which is just 4, minus the other side squared, so minus x squared. Well, that's interesting. That is this expression, that insight, that intuition that we may have had when we saw this right over here. But still, how does that help us? Well, this is where the trigonometry comes in. Because if we define, if this angle right over here, we say this is theta, then what is sine and cosine of theta going to be in terms of these sides? Well, let's see, the sine of theta is equal to the opposite over the hypotenuse is equal to x over 2. Or if you want to solve for x, we get x is equal to 2 sine theta. Well, that's interesting. What about the cosine of theta? Cosine of theta is equal to the adjacent side, square root of 4 minus x squared over the hypotenuse. Or if you want to solve for this side, it's going to be, we could say that the square root of 4 minus x squared is going to be equal to the hypotenuse times the cosine of theta. So that's interesting. If x is equal to 2 sine theta, then this other side, then this entire expression simplifies to 2 cosine theta. And that seems pretty interesting now. So let's make the substitution. Let's say that x is equal to 2 sine theta. And if x is equal to 2 sine theta, then dx is going to be equal to 2 cosine theta, d theta. And then if x is equal to 2 sine theta, then what is this thing right over here? Well, we just figured out this thing is 2 cosine theta. This thing is equal to 2, actually let me do it in that orange color, 2 cosine theta. This is equal to 2 cosine theta. And we were able to do this, drawing this right triangle and using the SOHCAHTOA definition of these trig functions. And obviously you could use unit circle, that's kind of an extension of these. But you could also do it if you say, hey, look, you know, if this is 2 sine theta, you could use the Pythagorean identity, our trigonometric identities, and you would see that this entire expression, if you did it that way, would simplify to 2 cosine theta. But now let's just run forward and let's see if we can evaluate it using this substitution. So this is going to be the indefinite integral, so dx, so 1 times dx, that's going to be dx is 2 cosine theta d theta. So let me write that. That is 2 cosine theta d, I'll write the d theta out here. And then what's the denominator? Square root of 4 minus x squared? Well, that's 2 cosine theta again. So that is 2 cosine theta. Well, this seems to work out quite nicely. If you, 2 cosine theta over 2 cosine theta, that's just going to be 1. This simplifies to d theta, which is, if you just evaluate this, this is just going to be equal to theta plus c. Well, this is kind of nice, but we're still not done. We want our indefinite integral in terms of x. So now let's just solve for x here. So if x is 2 cosine theta, or sorry, if x is 2 sine theta, so x is equal to 2 sine, x is equal to 2 sine theta, then let's see, divide both sides by 2, x over 2 is equal to sine theta. And then if you want to solve for theta, theta is the angle that if you take the sine of it, you get x over 2. So we could say, let's give ourselves another, a little bit more real estate, that theta is equal to the inverse sine of this thing, x over 2. We could write it that way. Or we could write that theta is equal to the arc sine of, the arc sine of x over 2. So this is going to be equal to the theta is arc sine of x over 2. So let's just do that. Arc sine of x over 2 plus c. And we're done. We've just evaluated that indefinite integral. Now some of you might have noticed something. I kind of brushed past it really fast just to give you the forest for the trees. But there's some interesting details that it's, I think, worth digging into a little bit over here. So the first one is, you might see that, look, the restriction on x here is, or the domain here on this expression is restricted. So let's just keep track of that to make sure that we didn't do anything strange when we did that substitution. So the domain here, x has to be greater than negative 2 and less than 2. If the absolute value of x were equal to 2, then you'd have a 0 in the denominator. If the absolute value of x is greater than 2, then you're going to have a negative in the denominator, and that's not defined. So this right over here is the domain. So let's say make sure that our substitution didn't do anything weird with that. So if x has to be between negative 2 and 2, and we're saying x is 2 sine theta, that means 2 sine theta would have to be between negative 2 and 2. So negative 2 would have to be less than 2 sine theta, 2 sine theta, which would have to be less than 2. We could divide all the different parts of this compound inequality by 2, and you're going to get negative 1 is less than sine theta, which is less than 1. And the way we can do that is if theta is less than pi over 2, at pi over 2, sine of theta would be equal to 1. And if theta is greater than negative pi over 2. So if we restrict it in this way, if we say theta is going to be in this range right over here, then we are restricting our domain in a reasonable way. And this works out well because this typically is the range for the arc sine function. So we could feel good about that. Now another question that you might have is, okay, well look, you know, we divided by cosine of theta here, but that's okay as long as cosine of theta does not equal 0, because you don't want a 0 in the denominator. And the good thing about this restriction on theta is as long as theta is greater than negative pi over 2 and less than pi over 2, cosine of theta is going to be, it's not going to be 0, and actually it's going to be positive. If negative pi over 2 or pi over 2 are allowed, then you would get a 0 down here, and we would have to think about restricting things in some other ways. So it looks like everything is cool. We dug a little deeper. We said, okay, we haven't done anything strange to the domain or to the unrestricted it in some strange way. And so we can feel good about this answer that we've gotten.